sound and dry and together, right? Right? So good morning, everyone in Facebook land. They're glad to have you with us today as well. Whoa. Well, that was...
Well.
Excuse me.
It was morning.
I couldn't. The wind. Yes.
The wind. I tell you, the wind. It's awesome. Okay. Prop that up there. All right. So if you can worship with us with standing and singing today, please do that and get ready to do some praising. We've got an amazing time. Lord God, thank you for this morning. Help us to sing praises to your name.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of all these. Who shares the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us reckless in awe and wonder, the brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like a sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King of all
verses this morning, Psalm 130, 1, 5, and 7. Let's read together. From a sea of troubles, I call out to you, Lord. Is that right there? I don't hear you. Okay. With all my heart, I'm waiting, Lord, for you. And then 7, Israel, trust the Lord. He is always merciful, and he has the power to save you. Amen. Right? Right, that's who we're singing about today.
Now you can't.
if you guys would go ahead and have a seat, we'll go into a time of prayer now. We have just a couple of updates so that we can remember and pray for these folks as well. Juliana said this morning as she came in, she was driving by Joyce Pinson's house and that there was a squad there, so she went in to check. Joyce Pinson's mother had a bad dizzy spell this morning, so please remember Joyce Pinson and her mom. And then from Joyce Peters, Ruby Messer, her brother Bill's best friend, is on life support, so please pray for Ruby. And then Joyce Peters' cousin, Charlie, has a mass on his lungs. And Joyce, we miss you, and we haven't forgotten you. She is kind of like homebound right now, so please lift the family there up in prayer. Shannon Medley also called in and let us know that some of her coworkers have COVID. And we know how serious this is across our town, across our county, across the state, and the country, and the world. So we need to continue fervently praying for healing, for protection, and everybody knows someone that's somehow affected. Our children in school, our teachers, I mean, it's everywhere. And God is everywhere as well. So everyone is coveting your prayers for that. We do have a praise list that's available, so I won't go through everything that's on the list, but just some call-outs, too. Some new requests that we had. Dan Shaw has a broken leg. Alex Matthews, work is crazy, and the kind of work he has in the medical field is intense. Dennis Camberling has heart issues. Kim Hughes in OR, the COVID cases, of course. And continue, please, to remember the Storm Steger family and with their loss. Gary Coleman with the Schmitter family. So let's bow our heads now and prepare to go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, you are awesome and you are glorious. And you created all of this for us, this world, our lives. You prepare us with everything we need. You even prepared for eternity with your Son, Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for the blessings that we've experienced. We thank you for healing with surgeries and for treatments that have strengthened us. We pray to you and thank you for those that are in the hospital that are recovering from surgeries and from illnesses. Thank you, Father, for even the liver that someone has that can now not have to go through dialysis. Thank you, Father, for preparing each day for us. And even today that we've come through a little storm and we're here together worshiping. Thank you for the new babies that are here. Continue to strengthen the moms and the families. Father, we lift up Joyce Pinson's mom and help her to be okay and to get through her dizzy spell. Father, our COVID, the COVID pandemic, Father, we ask that you heal it, heal our land, protect the people that are that have come under this illness. Father, thank you for the medical world that's helping us to survive. Thank you for your hand on every soul. Father, we ask that you open our hearts this morning so that we can hear your word. Bless Dan as he's preparing even now to come out and share what you've told him. Father, we lift up some churches in our area, Sunbury Church of Nazarene and Trinity Baptist Church in Marion. Bless them, Father, keep them safe, and help them to grow and to worship you. And now, Father, as we get ready to hear what your word has to say, again, please prepare our hearts and help us to bring honor and glory to your name. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning. Hope everybody's had a good weekend and kind of a wild weather weekend. I know it seems like I'm always talking about the weather, but I went to leave yesterday, and God had told me it was really cold and I might have to scrape my windows and to go out a little early. So at 10 till 6 yesterday, I went out to scrape my windows to go to work, and it was 26 degrees. And I'm like, oh, I'm not ready. But anyway, I did want to tell everybody, I had a wonderful time on Friday evening. We did something very different, and we had, because of the COVID virus and not knowing what direction it's going to go, we filmed the Thanksgiving. The Christian church brought all their cameras, and they set up around us, and they brought their film crew out, and it's kind of funny because not only are they going to edit the service, but us preachers are going to receive a blooper reel, which sounds kind of interesting, but it is going to be on Facebook on the Monday night before Thanksgiving, and somehow they are going to email us an address that we go to get it. See, I don't understand any of this stuff. And then the people here at this church that know how, like Peter and Leslie and Mike, they will put the Thanksgiving service on to our Facebook site, okay? And I'm clueless. But we really did have a wonderful time, and it was a good time to get together as ministers because it was weird. I mean, not the meeting wasn't weird. It's been a weird year to be a minister. But one of the things that they brought up that I loved, it's been a weird year to be a school teacher. It's been a weird year to be a fireman. It has been a weird year to be a nurse. Okay? It has been a weird year to be a doctor. And so it's just, you know, it was great being together with everybody, and I hope you'll look forward to that. I don't know the date. Let's see, the day's the 15th. That means next Sunday's the 22nd. It will be released Monday night, the 23rd at 7 o'clock. Now, here's the great thing. You don't have to pounce on it. You can watch it Tuesday morning. You can watch it with your family on Thanksgiving. You know, anytime after that, you can watch it. But I will tell you, Jerry Funston made something I never had in my life called Apple Bourbon Apple Crisp. And he made it in a deep cake and deep frying pan. Anybody ever heard of that? Oh, it was incredible. And he promised us that before we ate it, all the bourbon had been burnt off. So I don't want you to think anything bad about your pastor. But we really did have a good time. Hello, Facebook people. It is great to see all of you, and we are in John 18 today as we move forward with our study of John. Hope you've enjoyed John. I hope you feel like you've learned more about John than you ever know. I look today, and I'm in John 18, and it has taken from January 1st, whatever, to today to get through this, and I remembered one of my favorite preachers preached through 1 and 2 Samuel without stopping. And he told us all that he got hate mail. So if any of you are tired of John, I'm sorry, but you need to learn it. It's good stuff, and I hope you've enjoyed and got a lot out of it. But today we're going to concentrate on verses 1 through 11, and we're going to talk about a weird Thanksgiving November topic because it's just where we're at. We're going to talk about the arrest today, and as we go into that, we have to understand that as we move into John, we have to talk about and we have to address the crucifixion, because everybody wants to talk about the crucifixion at Easter, which is a nice time to talk about the crucifixion at Easter, but the crucifixion is the greatest event in our lives. Does everybody understand that? People look forward to Christmas and having the Christmas sermons about the little baby. And it's a lot of fun to talk about the baby, you know what I mean, and to talk about the birth. How many of you know that Jesus never talked about it? Did you know that? Jesus didn't talk about his birth. They basically think that everything we got about his birth, the disciples got from interviewing his mother after he ascended. But Jesus talked about the crucifixion all the time. He talked about it before it happened, and he talked about after it happened, and we don't talk about it because people think it's very dark. And it is dark. It is dark to know that the Son of God came and was mutilated and murdered in a horrible way for each and every one of us. And there's a great deal of guilt that comes with that. But there's also a great deal of passion that comes with that. There's a great deal of pride that comes with that. Have you ever watched one of your kids make a sacrifice for you? Doesn't that make you feel good? You ever watch your parents make a sacrifice for you? And didn't that make you feel good? Well, what about God making the ultimate sacrifice for you? Doesn't that make you feel wonderful and fantastic? And so as we study the crucifixion, one of the things it starts with is it starts with the arrest. And the arrest happens on a night of betrayal and fear. It's a night of pain and sorrow. There's a lot of bad things that happen. You know, we love talking about the upper room service. We just finished talking about the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus prayed in the upper room service. But then there's the arrest, which, you know, I love a list of hands. I like seeing this. If you raise your hands, you people at home on Facebook, please raise your hands. Actually, raise your heart. You know, put a little heart on or anything. How many of you have been taught and really fully understand that everything about the arrest of Jesus Christ violated Jewish law and it was totally illegal? How many of you knew that? You know, a lot of people think it was just a normal arrest. That they just came in, kicked the door open, and said, "Freeze!" And it wasn't anything like that at all. It was totally illegal. It was totally against Jewish law. And it makes me think, and I'm not even sure there's a verse about it, because I was trying to think about it the other day. How many of you love the old spiritual, "Were You There?" You know, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord?" Boy, Russ Taff has a version of that that he did on an album that is just unbelievable. But were you there? Were you there? Can you think about the night that Jesus was betrayed and arrested? Because it really, really is a defining moment in our relationship with Jesus. It brings us to a whole new passion. It brings us to a whole new development in how we want to have a relationship with Jesus, how we want to act in our relationship with Jesus. And so as we picture this, it helps our relationship with Jesus. And today, we're going to talk about that. And it may seem weird to talk about that 2 weeks before Thanksgiving, but you need to be thankful that Jesus was arrested. You need to be thankful that Jesus was arrested illegally, because it represents the sin of the world, oh yeah? See, you know, one of the things that boggles me and it makes me really mad, and here I go, I'm going off on a rabbit trail here. But one of the things that boggles my mind is when it gets towards Easter season, have you ever watched, do you ever get excited because it says, "Oh, the historical channel's doing a special on Jesus. I bet that's going to be great." And then by the time it's halfway through, you break your TV because it's pure blasphemy. Well, if you ever watch them, they do not tell that Jesus was arrested illegally. They make you think that Jesus was a rabble-rouser and that he'd done a lot of things to offend Pilate and they'd done a lot of things to offend Caesar. They don't ever tell the truth that he was totally beloved by the people, and so everything was done in secrecy. And everything was done in violation. We're going to talk more about the trial. The trial was all held in the middle of the night. How many of you have ever been to the Delaware courthouse to a really important trial at 2:30 in the morning? Really? They must have them all the time, because they sure did this to Jesus. And so we need to learn these things and be thankful for them, because our salvation comes from the crucifixion of Jesus, the fact that he sacrificed himself for each and every one of us when he didn't have to. I still love the old song, He Could Have Called 10,000 Angels. He could have ended it at any time, but he didn't. He endured it and went through it. And so it's important for us to see how much he loves us by what he went through. And that's what we're going to be talking about. And before we do, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we come to you today just blessed beyond belief that you love us so much. And Lord Jesus, we want to strengthen that relationship with you because we love you beyond belief. And you love us even more. And help us to grow deeper in that love. And help us to find peace in our love of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, today we're going to start off talking about that perfect place. Did you ever have a perfect place? A place that just brings so much happiness to you. You know, maybe it's a place you go walk. Maybe it's a vacation place. I know if I'm in Myrtle Beach or Hilton Head walking down that beach, it's tough to imagine a happier place on earth. It's just so wonderful to experience that and to go through. And did you ever have a perfect place like that? And did you ever have a perfect place that a bad thing ruined it? Did you ever have a perfect place that a bad thing ruined the perfect place and so that you didn't enjoy it anymore? I know one year, a thing that I'll tell you about, one year I was really blessed. My dad was dying, and things were really bad, and I really wanted to do something with the family. And Becky gave us this humongous Marriott place in Panama City, Florida. Okay, and I got to tell you, we drove into town, and it was one of the most beautiful places I'd ever been in my life. We went over this bridge that went over the Gulf, and I'm sitting here driving. And I'm not driving very good because I look over the side of the bridge, and there's three dolphins doing the flipper thing, you know what I mean? And going up and over the way. I'm like, this is the most beautiful place in the whole world. I just absolutely love this. And as the week went on, my dad died a little bit each day. And he lost a little bit of his mind each day. Everything were there. I tell you, to be honest with you now, and I'm sorry, Becky, what a beautiful place. You couldn't make me go back to Panama City, Florida. A lot of you remember we got home and Dad died within 2 weeks. You couldn't make me go back to that town. I have no desire to see it again. I don't think about it. I never look at the pictures. I don't enjoy it. Have you ever had a place that was ruined like that? And the reason I bring that up is because today we're talking about the Garden of Gethsemane. Because Jesus and his friends loved the Garden of Gethsemane. And I got to be honest with you. They went there all the time. People didn't go there. It was a great place to hang out. And when we think of the Garden of Gethsemane, we just have horrible thoughts, don't we? How many times when you hear the Garden of Gethsemane, do you think of the fun times that Jesus and his disciples had there? Any? Do you think about them laughing and talking and eating a sandwich? No. You think about the night of the arrest. And the Garden of Gethsemane is not a bad place. I guess that if you go there today, I'm looking at Dave. Dave's been to the Holy Lands. I guess you can go to the Garden of Gethsemane today. And did you get to go to the Garden of Gethsemane? Yeah, it's a beautiful place. Yeah. And Gethsemane was actually a Hebrew word for olive press. Because I have to be honest with you, to my knowledge, I have never seen an olive tree. Now today I'm really into response. How many of you have ever seen an olive tree? I guess they're quite beautiful. Kind of look like a Spanish moss tree or something. Kind of. Is it? Does it look like this ugly walnuts in my backyard or no? But anyway, olive, you know, they would go there for the peace of this garden. And starting out in 1 through 2, it says, when Jesus had finished praying, he and his disciples crossed to the Kidron Valley and went into the garden. Jesus had often met there with his disciples, and Judas knew where the place was. So Jesus loved this place, and he really enjoyed it. But the bad news was the one that betrayed him, Judas, knew where the place was too. Because Judas had had many of a wonderful time there with the disciples because they went there so often. It was such a quiet and secluded hangout, and they could just be themselves. And Jesus didn't have people running up saying, heal me, make food for me, you know, become the king. All the things that they were constantly yelling at Jesus about. So it was a place that he could go pray, relax, be with the disciples, teach them a little bit, and be with the Father, and just relax. It was a quaint spot just outside of Jerusalem that you could just walk to a little bit. I tried to research, and I could not get an exact distance. So I don't know how far, but I think it might have been like a half mile, if that, that you just walked out of town to. You don't even think it was that far, Dave? If that, you know, just a little place that they walked out to. It was a perfect place for a group of friends to meet. But we also have to understand it was the perfect place for a secret arrest. This was not a place where crowds drew. This is not a place where people converged on Jesus. This is a place where Jesus knew that he could go in quiet. So it was also a place that Judas, as he's betraying Jesus and talking to the Sadducees and Pharisees, and the people in the temple, the priests, when we go to arrest him, you can do it here because I guarantee you he'll go here because they go here constantly, you know? And so what happens is a beautiful place that had so many great memories turns into a tough place. And why? Because of sin. Why? Because of sin. Sin can take a beautiful place and ruin it. Oh, yeah? You know? So, as they come to arrest Jesus, and as we give the rest, we come to the question, is this the man? Because we know that, you know, there weren't wanted posters of Jesus out. There weren't really pictures, and some of the people who were sent to arrest Jesus had probably never even seen him before, which we think that's kind of rare, but remember, they didn't have CNN. We've seen everybody now, haven't we? If you haven't seen him on CNN or Fox, you see him on YouTube or somewhere, everybody's picture is up everywhere. It cracks me up because I tell these kids that I'm friends with at the hospital, I was born in 1960. Do you know how rare it was to know what any of your football heroes looked like? You could be a big football star and walk down the streets in public and nobody even knew because you always had bars across your face. They didn't constantly have cameras in their faces with them. They weren't constantly doing commercials and things like that. Baseball players, it was a very popular sport, and people knew baseball players because they saw their face on TV. Most of us still today know what Babe Ruth looks like. You know, you could probably pick him out in a lineup. Okay, but very, very few people know what some of the great football players of all time look like, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, because they didn't see him. Well, if you think about that, you understand why they really didn't know for sure what Jesus looked like. It was very easy for him to blend into a crowd. That's why when we talk about the Transfiguration, it's such a miracle. One of the miracles of the Transfiguration is that the disciples knew who Moses and Elijah was. They'd never seen a painting of them. They'd never seen a drawing. They'd never seen anything. And they instantly knew that it was Moses and Elijah. Well, we talk about the same thing with Jesus. And as we know, one of the horrible things that's going to happen is that Jesus is going to be betrayed by a friend. And Judas was a friend to Jesus. There's some controversy today because some scholars say that it's a horrible plan that God had because Judas was doomed to betray Jesus and he never really stood a chance because Jesus even says that the betrayer is cursed by greater than all other men. Okay, but the thing of it is that Jesus gave him every chance. God knows the outcome. God doesn't plan our outcome. God just knows what we'll choose. Does that make sense? I heard it explained one time, it's like Back to the Futures, that we actually have like 700 million choices that we can make in our life that all bring different outcomes, and God knows them all in his infinite wisdom. That's hard for us to understand, isn't it? But at the same time, we understand that God knew that no matter what choice, he knew that how Judas was, that he was going to make that choice to betray Jesus, which is why we had the prophecies. And what is betrayal? Betrayal is to be disloyal or treacherous to a friend. And we have some confusion in the church of what it is to betray Jesus today as a Christian. And I'll be honest with you, most people think that to sin is to betray Jesus. And I'm just going to tell you, to sin is to be who you are. That is not a betrayal to Jesus. You live in the world and you're going to sin. If you think you're not going to sin anymore, you should be up here preaching. If we have anybody out here pure of sin, congratulations. You made it. I don't think there is such a person. Matter of fact, God's word tells me there's no such person except for Jesus. Okay? So when we talk about betrayal, it's not so much when we sin. Betrayal is when we actually do things to hurt Jesus. When we actually do things to hurt him. And sometimes in the church, we can plan to do things that hurt Jesus, right? I mean, one of the things is when we just totally refuse to love people. And I see that all the time. You know, people say, well, what kind of things do you think are betrayals? Well, I think if you're a follower of Christ and you go out and you tell everybody that you're a follower of Christ and you're a closet racist, you betrayed Jesus. Okay? Because you're supposed to love everybody. And what a betrayal to tell a certain group of people, I don't love you because of the way God created you. You know? And I think we do betrayals like that. And I think it's important that we understand that, because we get in a place where we think, and I've heard sermons on it before, where when you sin, you betray Jesus, but yet we know that we are children of Adam, and Jesus had to die for our sins, oh yeah? And so though we work really hard to be sin-free, but I'm going to be honest with you. When you gave your life to Christ, you needed forgiveness of your sins, and if you think that event stopped you from ever sinning, you have a gross misunderstanding of the entire Word of God. Because as hard as we try, and that's why we love so much to differentiate sin. That's why we love to have major sins. You know what I'm saying? Because then we can feel confident. Oh, wow. You know, maybe I do that, but I don't do any of these. Doesn't it make you feel better? That you got a list up here that you don't do any of those. And in 3 through 7, Judas had promised to betray Jesus, so he went to the garden with some Roman soldiers and temple police who had been sent by the chief priests and the Pharisees. They carried torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus already knew everything that was going to happen, but he asked, "Who are you looking for?" They answered, "We are looking for Jesus from Nazareth." Jesus told them, "I am Jesus." At once they all backed away and fell to the ground. Jesus again asked, "Who are you looking for?" "We are looking for Jesus from Nazareth," they answered. You know, it doesn't talk about it in John, but I think we have to talk about it again about as we talk about the relationship with Jesus. That when Judas betrayed Jesus, he did it with a kiss. He did it with a kiss. And I think that's what we have to watch for as Christians, that we don't betray Jesus, because we tell him how much we love him. I hope you do. I hope you pray and tell Jesus how much you love him. I hope you have that kind of relationship with him and you're really close with him and that he feels your passion for him to the point of when you would betray him, it's like doing it with a kiss. And isn't that a horrible way to do it, to have somebody come up and kiss you on the cheek to send you to crucifixion? And so when Judas betrays Jesus, he does it for a kiss, but they say, "Who are you looking for?" because they don't really know which one he is, and then he goes up and does it. and they're looking for Jesus. And Jesus says, I am. This translation says, I am Jesus, but we have to really truly understand the Greek, and the Greek going back to the Hebrew, and actually what Jesus said is, I'm God. When Jesus responds, I'm Jesus, he actually says, I'm God. Jesus said, I am, several times, and it's really in the book of John more than anywhere else, and everybody is extremely heated and mad. They want him dead, because you have to understand, Jesus said, I'm God. And for most of us to understand, we have to go back to where we got some of our greatest Bible learning from the great biblical scholar Cecil B. DeMille. A truly godly man who filmed the Ten Commandments because the Jewish people needed something to watch during Easter. And you will never forget Charlton Heston saying, who are you? And the bush said, I am. Remember that? And we understand that. Well, I want you to take what the bush said when he said, I am, and I want you to understand that that's what Jesus said to the people there to arrest him in the garden. He said exactly what the burning bush said to Moses. I am Yahweh. I am God. I am the creator of the heaven and the earth. I am everything. And the reaction is they fell back. They fell down. They fell down. Now, one of the things about him falling down is when we watch our movies like The Robe or different movies that you've watched, because we love watching movies about Jesus, don't we? And when we watch that, there's like 10 to 12 people come to arrest Jesus. And it boggles people's mind to know that this was a subset of a Roman legion. And the subset that they sent, when you look at the actual Greek word, stands for 600 to 1,000 soldiers. So when you're thinking that 10 to 12 people went to the Garden of Gethsemane to arrest Jesus, you're wrong. And why not? Because I'm going to tell you, ignorance is really a wild thing, isn't it? I mean, if a UFO landed today, a serious UFO, and TV cameras are on it and everything, how many platoons of army people would we send up there to deal with the unknown? It wouldn't be a thing of, hey, Ralph, take your shotgun and go out there, and we're all going to watch to see if they disintegrate you. Right? Wouldn't we send a whole bunch of army and tanks and everything to go out there to the poor alien that's out there? Okay, well, think about this. This man fed 10,000 people with nothing. This man raised people from the dead. This man cured leprosy. This man made the blind see. We don't know what kind of rays are going to come flying out of his eyes or his hands. We're going to take a whole bunch of soldiers. But the miracle of it isn't in how many soldiers they sent to arrest Jesus. The miracle of it is that when he says, I am God, they fall down. And what do we know that the Bible tells us? Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess at the name of Jesus Christ. Oh yeah? And at the name of the living God, these soldiers all fall down in his presence, in his awe. Perfect opportunity for everybody to run. And people will say, why didn't Jesus run? Jesus didn't run because of how much he loved you. Jesus didn't just snap his fingers and destroy all those people because of how much he loves you. And one of the things I love about this is it helps you to understand the very power that Jesus had, that with one word, all these soldiers fall down. Do you find that not totally amazing? Do you find that not awesome? to understand that information, to know the true power of God, and that at any time Jesus could have done that, but yet for you, he stood there and let him take them, take him into what they took him into. You know, everything that's going to happen will happen. And we know that. We like to try to change events, don't we? If things are going to be bad, if things are, you know, scary, we like to try to change it from happening. And we really don't like to just accept the will of God. And I think that as we look at these scriptures and understand this, there's a couple things we see here. First, as we read even just the book of John, we knew the time of the arrest was coming. Act like you're a first-time Bible reader. As you have read through this, did you not know that Jesus is going to die on the cross? Because how many times did he tell us that I'm going to die on the cross and raise in 3 days? Right? We knew the event was coming, and yet when the soldiers come into the garden to grab him, we're all shocked. Right? And that's the same way that we know that the time of Jesus is coming back. We know all the prophecies that are going to happen. Yet as we see the prophecies unroll, however you want to say that, I can't find the right word this morning, but as we see the prophecies roll out and be fulfilled, that the time grows closer, that Jesus is coming, are we ready? Because we knew what he said the first time was going to happen, and we were shocked and amazed. Are we going to be shocked and amazed the next time? I mean, if people start disappearing today, are you going to be shocked that they're flying into the air? If you start flying up, are you going to be shocked? Or are you going to be like, boy, I wasn't ready for this? Why not? There's a whole lot of stuff that you can read in Revelation and in Daniel and everything that can be interpreted right now as that the rapture could happen any minute. Are we ready? Do we believe? Do we trust him? Because they weren't ready. In 8 through 11, it says, this time Jesus replied, I've already told you that I am Jesus. If I am the one you're looking for, let these others go. Then everything will happen. Just as I said, I did not lose anyone you gave me. Simon Peter had brought along a sword. He now pulled it out and struck at the servant of the high priest. The servant's name was Malchus, and Peter cut off his right ear. Jesus told Peter, put your sword away. I must drink from the cup that the Father has given me. No one is lost. No one is lost. Jesus said nobody would be lost except for the one who betrays me. And so the 11 all escaped from the garden without arrest. We can read other scriptures and it tells them that one of them took off running so fast that it ripped his clothes off in a bush. So one of them streaked home. But no one was lost. And he says, put your sword away. You know, do we have a sword? Do we have a sword that we think Jesus needs us to defend him in a way that is not the way Jesus wants us to? Because I think sometimes we do. I spend a lot of time with people who aren't Christians. And I try to find out why they don't believe. And I see the way they are attacked by people in the church for things that they have done or things that they've said. And they're literally attacked. You know what I mean? And made to feel guilty and made to feel awful and made to feel, I don't know, like right where I was before I accepted Christ. Oh, yeah? Right where you were before you accepted Christ? And right where the people who attacked them were before they accepted Christ? And they have the right to go on these attacks and these rants. And this poor soldier, temple associate to a temple priest, he comes up there, and the whole reason he's there is what? He was ordered to. Do you think Malchus got a bunch of guys together and said, let's go kill Jesus? But they all knew Malchus. You know why I'm telling you they knew Malchus? Because as we look in the other Gospels, we see that Jesus picked up Malchus's ear and put it back on. How much you want to bet that Malchus was a big member of the early church? I know a guy cuts my ear off with a sword, and this guy puts my ear back on, and then in 3 days they're talking about him raising from the dead. I'm going to be at those services. I'm going to be there when they talk about him, and I'm going to tell about what he did to me. And they all knew Malchus, didn't they? And I'm pretty sure that they got to hear Malchus testify a few times about what he'd done. But you know what? Jesus had to go through what he went through, and he went through for everybody. And our job is to, with love, let everybody know what he went through and to be there to show that to them and to show them God's grace and mercy, not to use a sword on them. Are we quick to use that sword? We have to learn to put that sword away and learn to love. And learn to love like Jesus did. But in order to do that, we have to trust Jesus. And today, what we ask you is, do you trust Jesus? Do you trust Jesus that even if he's arrested at the garden, that he lives for you? That even as he's hauled off for a crucifixion, that he rose again, and that he's in control of everything in the universe? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you today Just for your unbelievable love. I thank you for your grace and your mercy. And I thank you for how you just take care of us. And I thank you for the chance to witness to others about you with your love and not a sword. And yeah, there'll be people rise against us and they'll be nasty and hateful. But do we respond with love the way that you did? Or can we pull out the sword? Help us to be full of your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to do something special today. I want to talk to you for a minute, and I prayed a lot about how to word this, but I think it's very important that we talk about this. This might be our last Sunday, and I hope everybody's watching the news and aware of that. We had a new floor at the hospital every day. When people ask, why is there a shortage of staff? The reason there's a shortage of staff is that one nurse can only take care of two patients. Did y'all know that? COVID patients takes one nurse to take care of two of them for 12 hours. So as they add each floor, and some of these floors are, is it 32 or 42 patients? 32 patients. That means that 16 nurses have to be on staff at all times to take care of these people, and they require so much care. And I don't know how many of you know this, but as of Friday, over 8,000 cases have been reported in the state of Ohio, and some of your friends in this community have it. And people say, well, tell us names. I don't understand. I told Kyle and Kelly this morning, and we were talking about it to the ministers the other night. People that are getting this are acting like it's scabies or lice. And like there's shame for anybody to know. We need publicness. We need for more people to know that their friends have it. Oh, yeah? Because too many people think that for some reason they're invincible to it. But I know one thing that I'm a little disappointed to in the church. I don't think the church is praying enough about it. I don't know anybody's prayer life. I know how much I'm praying about it every day. I know how serious we make every Wednesday night's prayer meeting about it. But today, before we leave, I want to pray about it. I want us to pray together. We're not going to come together and hold hands because that's exactly what we're not supposed to do. But where you're sitting, I don't want you to listen to me pray. I want you to pray. And I want you to ask God to get rid of this stuff. People are dying. My boss sent me articles about there's different things in people's blood that's causing different families to react to it differently, and it kills them. Doesn't matter if they're 20, doesn't matter if they're 70. And he got the article to me because of how many people Janice and Paul Thomas have lost in their family that don't even live close to each other. Because it drives me nuts. Why is it hitting that family the way that it is when they're not even getting together? It's just happening wherever they live. And so this is really terrible stuff. And we need to be in serious prayer about it. So let's go to the Lord and pray. God, we come to you today just overwhelmed. This stuff is so terrible. What it does to people, we hear about people that it's just a couple days flu and nothing happens, but I was told today about somebody that it caused their intestines to explode. It does so many things to so many different people. But the one thing it does is it causes fear. And we hear the question, why would you let this happen? And you don't let this happen. But we know if we call on your name, you'll end it. We ask that you would take this away. We ask that you would heal our world and heal our nation and heal our community. And Lord, we pray for the nurses and doctors. They're so exhausted. They're working so many hours. And they're scared. And then they get it. We pray for the schools. Because the cases in the schools are going up and up and up. And more teachers. And I even know of a superintendent that has it. And it's just growing and growing and growing. And Lord, we like our normal lives. And we pray for people's jobs. I ate a restaurant Friday that you were there, Lord. We asked the waitress if there was anything we could pray for her for, and she said that the boss had told them they were probably closing Monday. And she didn't know where money was going to come for her and her two children. And Lord, there's so many of these cases out there. And we ask that you would help it to go away so these people can have what they need. But Lord, help us to realize as a world that you are in charge. And I don't know why more people aren't calling on you. Because you promise us for whatever we call out for in faith that you will give us. And Lord, I just ask that you will end this. And heal us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I did want to tell you, be listening for announcements. I don't know what the governor's going to announce. Lord willing, I'm praying hard, we'll all be together next week. But we will do what the government asks us to do. The elders will meet. One thing is, I know a lot of you know that next week is the big Thanksgiving offering. If anything happens before the Thanksgiving offering, I encourage you to do one of two things. If you have bought your groceries, we will announce drop-off times here at the church, and you'll be able to just drive up and drop it off, and we'll pack it back, and I'll get some people that will help me take it to Big Walnut Friends Who Share. Okay? If you do not want to do that, we encourage you to send us checks. But the checks, please make sure you make out the checks to Big Walnut Friends Who Share. It sure makes life easier on Evelyn and Karen, because if you send a check for us to give to Big Walnut Friends Who Share and you make it out to the bridge, Evelyn puts it in our bank account, Karen writes a check to Big Walnut Friends Who Share. Did y'all know that? And so if you want to write a check, write the check to Big Walnut Friends Who Share. Okay, and we will make sure through Marcia that we get the money, and we'll make sure that through Marcia we get all the groceries. But please be in prayer, and please pray that we're together next week. All the ministers the other night prayed about we want a Christmas Eve service. I know that sounds silly, but Christmas Eve is such a big thing. It's so exciting. It's so much fun. It's such a family time. That year I went to Florida for Disney World, I hated the trip because I hated missing Christmas Eve. Y'all know that? I had a wonderful time with my kids, but I hated not being together with everybody for Christmas Eve. So please be praying and keep safe out there, because it's a crazy, crazy tough time. Thanks, everybody.
I come to the garden.
Praying to do, we have a lot of praising to do. So as we end our service, we have at the count of three. Yes. All right, December daily breads are here outside the foyer there, so please grab one so that you have some great devotions. And let's just a quick word of prayer, and then we'll share the love. Father, thank you for being awesome, for being mighty. Thank you for walking with us. Be with us as we serve you, love you, and pray. In Jesus' name, I thank you. Amen. All right, folks, on the count of three, one, two, and three, share the love. Bless you.